Thank you. Okay, welcome everybody. I'm going to tell you something about deployment. First, I have to say I'm having this cold for a couple of days, so I'm sorry if I sound like my grandmother. I'm first going to start with an introduction. My name is Robert van den Bogert. I am a PHP developer at iBuildings. I like to call myself a web enthusiast, but I think we all are, else we wouldn't be here. I also like to travel, and I call myself the average Joe because I'm not really that special. So, first, a little disclaimer. This talk is heavily opinionated, so I will mention some tools which are great for the job. I'm not saying they are the best tools. I just think they are great, and I'm sure there will be decent alternatives, which I will not talk about. So, we are here for deployment. I'm going to start with some horror stories to get you all warmed up. Then I'll show some common pitfalls, which we will all recognize, I guess. Then we are going to see what we want to achieve at the end. Then we are actually going to build a deployment script. And I'll show you some integration tools for how to do it and stuff that could come in handy to do that. Okay, horror stories. FTP is a great protocol for transferring files. I hear some people laughing. It's not so great for transferring your 25,000 files counting project while your production server is down or showing fatal errors or whatever. It's a great tool and can actually be part of your deployment script, but you cannot consider it a deployment script. The same goes for rsync. It's a great tool for file synchronization. I think it's better than FTP for this purpose. Also, you cannot consider rsync as a deployment tool, but you can use it as part of. Versioning checkout is already slightly better. But again, you need some extra stuff to do when you are deploying your application to the server. And this one is actually, I really had this one time. One of my customers called me and said, hey, sorry, I blocked my firewall. So here's your login code for TeamViewer. And I could there access all of their internal network files on a Windows server. So that was great. But I didn't have privileges to edit or install the right tools. So I was there on their production server editing in Notepad, their live site. I don't think I have to say that's not how you should do it. Okay, let's start with problems and solutions. Some common pitfalls. Manual operations, something you don't want. Slow deployment processes is also, you don't want that. Downtime is an issue. Cache is something important for this. Migrations, I will all enlighten this in the next slides. A lot of deployment tools or scripts have no possibility to go back to the point you were. So let's start with manual operations. It's just simple answer. No, never have manual operations. Just make sure that when you are updating your deployment wiki and adding another story, if you go there, then click this button and do this and execute that command. No, you could have already written your automated deployment for those steps, so you should not do that. There's also the bus factor. Within a lot of projects, there's only one guy who knows how to deploy. Well, if he comes under a bus, then, well, we all be fucked, I guess. We know that saying. Oh, this is on video, right? Yeah, you can cut that out. Beep! You want your developers to be able to deploy from any place, anywhere, anytime. And before, I had a tryout with this talk, and I made a joke about Nena. But are there some Germans here? Yeah. Do you get it? No? Oh. Okay. Nena is a Dutch singer, and she had a song called Any Place, Anywhere, Anytime. Okay. Also, you want to make sure that your developers are confident. There's nothing as wrong as your developer shaking behind his computer because he has to do a deploy again, and something goes wrong, and he's in stress, and he has to fix stuff on production. You want to avoid that. So the main purpose of this talk is to have confidence about your deployment. Yeah, no turning back. I don't have to talk about this a lot. I think everybody knows this. When something goes wrong, and a lot can go wrong while doing your deployments, you want to make sure that you have a point in time where you can go back to fix the problem, and then do another deployment. So you should make sure you have a mechanism for that. This one is a bit drastic. I have to say, I want to say no more under construction pages. But I have to make that more subtle, because in some cases you need it. But this is something you need to keep in mind. You should always strive for zero downtime. That's when you think about your deployment, that's when you write your scripts. Always make sure that the downtime is, well, at least close to zero. I mean, it can be necessary to have downtime, but just make sure that you make it quick. Therefore, you need to make sure that your deployments are quick. I would say you do small releases, because then the risk of having errors or also the deployment time will be less. And you need to automate the shit out of your process. It's just make sure that everything is within one script, and you can just easily hook it in and run it. So we're going to do that next. Cache is also a thing. Many people don't consider this as an important part of the deployment process. I actually think it is a big part of it, because if you are going to do several deploys a day, you need to make sure that those are quick, and also that the website doesn't slow down every time. So when you do a deploy, the cache has to be warmed up, and then your visitors are waiting for a minute. You don't want that. So you need to make sure that your cache is warmed up before you actually show it to your web visitors. Then we have migrations. I'm going to read you an email I got from my fictive colleague Alex. Hi, fellow developers. Please make sure that when you do the next deploy, you run the following query on the database. Some very complicated query to migrate data. Oh, and make sure you move all user data from this directory to that directory. Fuck you, Alex. You're going to forget this. This is not what you want. If my other colleague has been to the escape yesterday, but wants to do a hotfix deployment today, he forgets about this email, and the application is broken, and nobody knows why. So you want to have stuff like this centralized within your deployment script. And that's what you have migrations for. So, in short, this is what we don't want, and this is what we want. Instead of manual operations, we want automation, we want quick rollouts, we want zero downtime, the cache needs to be warmed up, we want migrations, and we want rollbacks. So, let's start from the beginning. A lot of people actually think that the deployment is only important at the end of your project, or at least when you're doing your first deploy. When sitting around the drawing table for your project, you need to make sure that you already mention this topic. You need to talk about it with your client. You need to free budget for it, because the first time you write the script, it will take a lot of time. I can assure you that. So if you don't think about this on beforehand, then yeah, it might not be so successful. And it's really a critical part of your development process. So I would say think before you act, or else it will get very messy eventually. It's also important to manage your expectations. Of course, the customer needs to define what he expects. So what would be the release cycle? Maybe you can only do releases at night. That changes your strategy for it. Maybe he wants a lifetime update, so just every 5 minutes or whatever. Also, you need to inform your web visitors when you do a deployment. So if something goes wrong, you can show a fail whale or whatever. And also, the project manager, of course, needs to know what to expect from you as a developer. And you need to be on one page with your development team and your testers, because everybody needs to be on the same page for the deployment script. So when you're creating a deployment strategy, you should think about your release cycle. I already mentioned that. You think about your server setup. I'll show you an example. Your branching strategy. And of course, the tools you're going to use for it. So this is a basic DTAP setup. You have a development environment. You push your stuff to the repository. Then it goes to test, of course, if the build is not broken. If test is succeeding, you go to the acceptance stage. And then at the end, if everything is right, you go to production. So remember this picture as we go along. In order to do this, I would say use Git. Seriously. It's reliable. It's super fast. I think in order to create your fast deployment script, this is the fastest versioning I know of. It has very easy branching and merging, so you can set up different branches for your different deployment servers, for example. It's distributed. A lot of people might say that it's actually a con. I just want to say for this purpose, it is a pro because you can set up different repository origins. And so you can fall back when, for example, GitHub is down. And that happens sometimes. So GitHub, I think it's really added value for you. But of course, that's personal preference. It has a good user interface. There's a lot of extras like the pull request system. And I would say just if there's anyone who didn't use Git yet, just try it out for your next project. And you can determine for yourself. Also, GitHub has a lot of integration with existing deployment tools. And also with, for example, with Jenkins, Travis CI, you can trigger hooks. So when you commit something to your branch, you make sure that the build doesn't break. Stuff like that. So that's good for your deployment process. Well, then there's this thing. I think everybody will know some stuff about this. What if you have a framework? What if you have libraries? What if you have QA tools or private repositories? You all want them to be combined in your project. I would say, drum roll, please. Sorry. Composer, I think it's awesome. Again, personal preference, but it's super easy to set up and integrate in your deployment script. You can just, this is actually a working config file. You just manage some tools you want to use in your project. And if you just do a Composer install inside of your deployment script, you can easily integrate it. And it works awesome. Okay. Migrations, you could of course write your own script. There's nothing wrong with that. I would say there are a lot of decent alternatives. So I'm just going to show you some existing ones. Of course, Doctrine migrations. You want to integrate something like this in your script in order to do migrations. There's also the DB Patch project, which is maintained by one of my colleagues. It's a cool project. Check it out. And of course, there are a lot of other ones shipped with your framework or your ORM. Sometimes it's better to use them, so you can determine for yourself. But no matter how cool your versioning system is or how good your migration scripts are, just always make sure that you have backups. I would say to always do a backup before you do a deployment. But I know there are some cases where that's not possible, maybe because you have a 2 GB database and that will slow down the entire server. Or I think you need to think about other stuff then. One possible solution could be to say, within your migration, if you're going to move some data around, you can just dump some table or just store some data somewhere, and then later on in the rollback you could set it back. That's I'm not saying that's a good solution, but that could be something, at least. But as the release manager of Facebook actually says, rolling back is for pussies. So, you want to have the ability to roll back, but it's better to don't. It's better to try to fix the problem and as quick as possible, because if you are going to roll back, you might create new issues. But of course, that's totally dependent on the incident. I just saw the toilet here. Did anybody see the toilet incident here? Oh, well, there was. It's almost wet here, so it was overflowing and everybody was running. And quite funny, but yeah. I mean, you can roll back, but you just have to fix it immediately. Yeah, so move fast and break things. That's the motto. Just try to do quick deploys, small releases, so you have less risk of errors and problems. Then a little thing about directory structure. This is actually a best practice which is applied in a lot of famous deployment tools. Let's say this is your root. You create a releases directory. Inside of that one, you use a unique hash for your version. And unless you are going to plan to do multiple deployments a second, this should be sufficient. You just use a timestamp, and then you know when that deploy has happened. Also, at the end of your deployment, so when you warmed up your cache, you run your migrations and stuff, you create a symlink, and we actually use the current for Apache, for example, to have as your root. So your root will always be this. So you're running everything when creating a new one in this folder, and then at the total end, you create a symlink from current to this one, and then the switch will happen. Does anybody have questions until now? No? Okay. So, we are going to build a deployment script. We're going to do a backup. We create a new directory. We update the code, update the dependencies, run the migrations, warm up the cache, and then let's start scripting, I would say. Or you could use one of the existing tools, because actually a lot of smart people already created this stuff for us. Fabric is something written in Python. I don't have experience with it, so I'm not going to talk about it. You could use thing or and for deploying, but they're more like build tools, so wouldn't have my my preparation. Sorry. Chef could also be used for deployment, but I'm choosing for Capistrano here because it is a great tool. I actually use it with pleasure. It's really powerful. It's really easy to set up. It's easy to hook into because you have an event-based system where you can just put your own tasks in it and trigger them. And it's written in Ruby. Some people might consider that as a con. I'll show you in the next slides that you only need to configure it and not actually write real Ruby code. So I don't think that's a big problem. It supports multiple servers, so you can have parallel deployment to different servers at the same time. And it has a multi-stage extension, which is handy for the DTAP setup, for example. I'm going to talk about Capiphany, which is just built upon Capistrano. A lot of config options and stuff I will show you are part of Capistrano, actually, but I'll just do it in one go. Capiphany has the power of Capistrano. It has a lot of tools for Symfony pre-configured. You can deploy from within one single config file. And I'm going to show you how to set it up. This is it. You install a gem. You go to your web root and you do Capiphany install dot. That's it. Now it's set up on your local machine. Of course, you need to configure some stuff. So with Capiphany, it will create a deploy.ruby file in your config directory. And I'm now talking about a Symfony application, just as an example, because Capiphany is for Symfony. You just set some variables. You set the name of your application, the directory on the remote server you want to deploy to. This is the domain it will run on. And here you can set the repository to use. I think it currently supports Subversion, CVS, Mercurial, and Git. I mean, of course, you should use Git, I think, but if you want to, you can use something else. Of course, we need to set it up on the remote server, and we actually do it like this. we go again to the web root. We do a cap deploy setup. It will connect with SSH to your remote server. It will run some scripts to initialize, create the right directory structure, set up some config and user permissions, and you're done. This is it. Now we can start deploying. The beauty of this is that the config file is within your repository. So you will just distribute that to all your colleagues so everybody can deploy if he wants to, and if he has access, of course. So let's do deploy. That's also easy. You go to your web root and do a cap deploy. That's it. Now it will connect to your server. It will run the migrations. It will run vendor updates, update your code, create symlinks. It will do everything for you. This is the only thing you need to remember from now on. So no more manual operations, no more big wiki pages about how you should deploy your application. This is just it. And I think that's great. If you did something wrong, you could do a cap deploy rollback. Then it will just restore the previous directory. And you go back and, everything should be working again. I'm going to show you some configuration options. This is, for example, the model manager for your migrations and setting up your tables and stuff. This is for Composer. I would highly recommend to use that with Capiphany. You should set update vendors to false, because else it will try to update the directories itself. You should use Compose to true. Vendors mode is install or setup, what you want to use. And then it will automatically update your vendor directories. You can dump your assets from a static. This is something also about the directory structure. And I'm going to show you that in the next link slide. Remember this directory structure? We have the releases directory. Besides that, there's also a shared directory. So in that folder, we store all the data that is not specific for a version. But we store, for example, user data, logging. It can be in the same one. So in this manner, it will just, after deploy, it creates a new directory. And it will create a symlink inside of the directory to all your shared directories. So that's quite convenient, too. If we go back to the DTAP setup, Capistrano comes with a multi-stage extension. You can configure it like this. You require the multi-stage. You set your stages. You can have multiple, as many as you want, doesn't matter. In this case, I just used a default DTAP. You set your default stage to test. I would recommend to always do this, because if you accidentally forget to pass in the stage you want to deploy to, it will fall back to this one. So if that's production, then you're accidentally deploying to production. You don't want that. Then you just set a stage there in which your config files will be for the specific stages. And this is just an example config. This is actually it. This is how you set up multi-staging. So here I just override some variables. I set the server to which it should deploy to, because, of course, that's different. And here, this is something for Symfony to enable the test application mode. Then something about user permissions. I'm actually really a noob with user permissions. I always have problems with that. So forgive me if I say something wrong. I would say to never use sudo for your deployment script, because I think it's bad practice. If you are going to integrate different tools in it, you don't want everything to give sudo access. But if you want to do special stuff with your user permissions, you need sudo writes. So in this case, you could set it to true to set up your stuff. You could create a user. It's just some standard config options. Don't forget this one, because I've actually been playing with this and it didn't work. And then I found out that I had to enable this. And you can set the permission method. They recommend to use ACL, but I have no experience with it, so I use chmod, and it works fine for me. I set no more under construction pages. That's actually not true. Just always make sure you have one, because you never know what could go wrong, and maybe your site is down for a day because something just totally broke down, just make sure you have set it up. So it's quite easy to do this with Capistrano. You can just say cap deploy web disable. That's a task to disable it, and it will replace your directory with a blank screen, just a blank page. And you can even pass in a reason and a until parameter, so it will just show a default message. We're upgrading our website. We'll be back in this time. If that's not fancy enough for you, you can actually override the template. So you could say, this is my template. This can be a Twig file or some template or another file you want to serve. And it will show you a fancy page, like a fail wheel or what you want to show. Okay, some short tips and tricks. This one is really handy. I got it from the Capiphany site. If you are using Git, you want to have flexibility in which thing you are going to deploy. So you can choose from, normally you would set a branch in your config, but you can also set branch and create a function for it. So you can actually ask the user what do you want to deploy. In this case, I take the tags. It's a bit hacky, but it works. I take the tags of my current branch, and it splits the last one out. So it will show you, I will show it in a minute. It will show you the last push tag. Then you use the Capistrano CLI util to ask the user, okay, what do you want to deploy? As the last, you set the default tag to this one. It will look like this. So here I'm actually already deploying. This is just a warning message that you actually pushed it to master, because it will try to get it from there. This is the default, but you can here you can enter whatever you want. So you can use a hash, you can use a branch name, you can use a tag, you can use head or whatever you want as an identifier. So yeah, that's pretty cool to use. Okay. This is for enabling SSH interaction. Some scripts might ask you for, hey, do you want to do this or that, yes or no? If you enable this option, you make sure that you can actually enter that input and it will do something with it. This one is really handy to know. If you are using GitHub with authorization keys and you are deploying to a remote server, it will pull the stuff from GitHub on that side. So if you want to forward your keys, you just enable this option, and it will do it automatically for you, so you don't have to log in again. This is something for cleaning up. The keep releases parameter is for setting how many directories should be kept after your cleanup, so in this case, I say 3. And this is just convenient to do after your deploy. This is how you define or trigger a task on an event. You say after deploy, deploy cleanup, and then it will just automatically clean it up every time you do a deploy, and just remain only the last 3 directories. This is also something I have enabled by default. After update code, migrate or execute my migrations. It doesn't do that by default. And this is something you can actually, if you would usually use App Console to do Symfony operations, you can do any task with just the Symfony prefix. So you can invoke Symfony colon and then your task you want to trigger. So what's next? System provisioning. I don't know who of you went to my colleague's talk yesterday, Dan. He was talking about Vagrant and Chef. For example, what if you are updating your PHP version or your development environment? You want to make sure that on the next deploy, also your test or production environment is also updated. So that goes for all of these things. I would say Chef is a great tool. There's also Puppet, of course. There are some other tools too. I use Chef, I know it, so I think it's great. You can version control your infrastructure by just putting your stuff inside of your code base. And you make sure that you have identical environments. That's really great to have. So also it integrates with Vagrant. So if you have a local virtual machine, you can just provision it with Chef. And then you can use the same recipes from Chef to provision your production server. So that's great to have. You can set it up like this. It's just, yeah, it's something I did. I'm not saying it's perfect. Actually, here I use sudo because Chef needs the sudo rights. So I say after update code, provision. And provision is just a task here. And it runs a Chef solo script on the remote server. And it will also update all of my system dependencies. So that's something I think is important to have because, yeah, if you have PHP 5.4 code and you're pushing to your server, it will just break down if your server is still in 5.3. So, but you need to make sure that you do this only at the last stage. So when everything finished successfully, then you should do this. So actually, I think I have it wrong here because I have it after update code. It should be later on. Sorry about that. Yeah, Vagrant already mentioned that. There's also, of course, build automation. If you have a script like this, it's very easy to set up continuous deployment. So when you have a build server and it succeeds, you could say, I don't prefer it, but some people like it, to just automatically deploy to your test server, whatever. Yeah, you could do that easily when you have a script like this. Jenkins, already mentioned that. It could do that. Also, any other CI server can do that for you. So, are we excited for the end result? Yay! Okay, I have two options. Everybody told me in the last couple of weeks, don't do a live deployment. I want to make it a vote so I can blame you guys. Shall we look at a lame screen capture? Or shall we... May I see hands for the screen capture? It's unanimous! I blame you! Okay, how am I going to do that? Just one sec. This is so stupid. Can everybody turn his Wi-Fi off, please? Thanks. Okay, so of course you don't see this. Ooh, now I have to type over there. Wow. Okay. Come on. How much time do we have left, actually? Does anybody know? Think quarter past two? Oh. It will be done then. Okay. Come on. Okay. No? No screen capture? Why is it doing this? Hey. Okay. Yes. And to make it even more interesting, this is actually a real project. So please don't look at my latest bug fixes. Okay, so we see here on the top, I have a tag which is called 01333RC5, and we're going to deploy that to my test server. Yeah, shall we do the hand thing again? okay, so there we go. I am in my web root, I think. Yeah. We do a cap deploy. Let the magic begin. Okay, so now it asks me. I could even say to just deploy master or whatever. It's actually, in this case, it's the same. But I'll deploy the tag. I hit enter. And there we go. I've never been so scared in my life. Okay, there we go. It's a bit too fast to show everything, but here it is running Composer. So it's updating all the vendors. Whoa, that's a big font. Okay. It's dumping the autoload, it's warming up the cache. It has already done a lot of other stuff. You see that warming up the cache takes some time. Yeah? No, to test. It's to test. Oh, yeah, okay. So this is the chef part. Of course, I don't just let them... Close your eyes, please. Okay, there we go again. Okay, chef is... I've put on the debug logger, by the way, so it's outputting a lot of information. So this is chef. It's now provisioning our system on the test server. So it's actually running apt update and stuff like that on the versions we want. Yeah, this is some NPM stuff for less. It's a bit too much output. Okay, running cache clear. I actually do this again because with chef thing, we also sometimes do some stuff for the database. So we need to make sure that everything is run again. Okay, this is aesthetic dumping. This is some custom scripts. And we have a successfully deployed. Thank you, thank you. So I actually think that was it. Where's my mouse? All right. Thank you very much.